become as popular as the nuclear bill. Thank you.
I'm going to ask three, then open the floor, and then we will try and summarize. Just as an aside, the intellectual property is also a very recent term. It has become quite popular, whether we like it or not. And the fact that you talk about common as much as commons, as being uncommon, I think there is an issue over there. But I think that this is, as we go along, we'll develop on these issues. Just as an aside, the left as well as the right both have supported open source. The Congress was silent on the
issue. The center is missing.
The center, Congress did not come with an open source policy.
I just thought that if the left and right marches together, you move forward. The situation that you're not moving forward.
Forward block.
So I'll basically focus on, what was that, sorry?
Forward block.
How could Congress ever imagine it will be a forward block?
That sounds like an oxymoron. Forward block.
Yes.
That's what he meant.
IPR block.
So I'll just focus on what Venki had put in over here, which is how can policy frameworks be altered to suit the new realities and what policies does India need? And I would kind of endorse quite a bit of what Pradeep was saying, completely agree with that, because there are many battles being fought in this war, and they're fought in different places. They're fought in courtrooms, they're fought in the realistic sphere that Eben operates in, they're fought in the corridors of power, in various rooms and so on and so forth. And getting the right language in is extremely important. And these are some of the issues that we have been looking at for quite some time. If we just come back to why businesses, and I'm talking about, when I say business, I mean small businesses, try to go for patents. Some of the refrain that I keep getting from the startups in IT Delhi, for example, and many other startups and small companies is, can you please get me in touch with a good lawyer? I want to patent something. I want to put my trademark, protect my trademark, not just copyrights and patents, but even trademarks. And to that extent, I completely resonate with what Eben was saying. Good lawyers are important. And that's important because we've got a bad system in place. If I draw the analogy way back in the 50s, you can write a good program. If you were a good programmer, the machines were quite esoteric, right? You cut back to 2010, my nephew, who's like 6-7 years old, can still write a program. He can build some kind of a program. He's not a good programmer, but he can build something because the machines have improved. In a similar analogy, if we can make our system better, if we can make our IPR system better, I'm so glad that Richard Stallman is not around because he wouldn't let us use the word IPR. We can talk a bit more freely. So we can, therefore, if we can work towards making the patent system and the IPR system much more amenable to these small businesses, that'll be extremely useful. But why exactly do they want patents? Why does a startup in IT Delhi want patents? Can they think in their wildest dreams to go ahead and defend a patent suit from a Microsoft or an IBM or a Samsung or Philips or whoever? No way. For them, in most cases, it's more of a marketing ploy. And you ask them point blank, why do you want it? Well, it's for marketing purposes, so that they can go ahead and convince the VC that, look, we have got these 2 or 3 or 4 patents, please fund us. And if that's the case, then why can't we have the petty patent regime, or as James was trying to build up the utility patent regime in India? I think that's something that's needed from a policy perspective. Also, what we have been doing from the academic hat that I wear is build something called Innovation Commons, which is now under Knowledge Commons. And can we then put all new ideas in an open forum, which establishes prior art and which can be published so that it can be referred back and you cannot have a patent against it? Because what happens is once you develop an idea, willy-nilly the idea leaks out and somebody else goes ahead and patents it. So in order to protect yourself, if you can go ahead and publish it in the open and then build the technology around it. Just to keep in mind, a patent is not the same as technology. Most of the time when IBM Labs makes money out of its patents, it's not from the patent, it's from the technology transfer. It takes $10 to do the technology transfer for every $1 of patenting work. So it's the technology is more important. You can go ahead and put your innovations in the open. Those two-page declaration means nothing. You can't have a $1 billion product based on a two-page declaration. Then also give legal basis for recognizing non-commercial patents and copyrights. Currently, there is no legal recognition for some of these open patents that you create. If I create a patent and I say, well, it's open for everybody, I don't get any legal document against it. I don't get, my submission is not covered under any legal protection directly. Yes, indirectly there is. Yes, I've established a prior art, but I can't mention it in my marketing documents. I'm not really talking about petty patents. I'm talking about somebody from Gumla coming in and saying, I know a better way of how to milk my cow. And what do we do about it? Well, I don't want a petty patent against it. I don't even want any other patents around it. I just want to make sure people know about it and it's recognized and it's there in paper in somewhere. So that kind of a legal framework, or more of a, for a better word, legal lollipop is not available. So some of those kind of a system would help in incentivizing these grassroots innovations to come out. If I can draw an analogy, which is not a perfect analogy, if you heard what Anshu was saying in OSDD, some university had come out with these two molecules from a plant extract which had anti-TB properties. If the lollipop of open source drug discovery was not there, if that platform was not there, these molecules would have never got discovered. They would have died out. And there are many such innovations that are dying out because the proper frameworks are not there. One can always come back and say, look, India is still very innovative. There's so much more innovations happening. But that's not the right benchmark. They're happening despite of all the blockages we are putting, despite the forward blocks that are there, right? We need to make sure that we open up all these blockages so that there are far more innovations that happen. And coming to a last point, in terms of the view from small companies, is the issue of community-owned patents. There is no concept of a community-owned patent. The person in Gumla would not figure out a better way of milking the cow without the community being around them. It's probably a bunch of people who came out with a new idea, and milking the cow is just a off-the-cuff example I'm taking. But the point is that there is no way to put a community as in charge of a patent. Yes, there are geographical patents and there are all kinds of patents, but there is no patent which says this district of Gumla or these five villages owns this property, this intellectual property. And that way it's free to everybody else from that point onwards. From a government perspective, why do you want patents? Obviously to have a sustainable innovation. The key word is sustainable. Now, is the current regime sustainable? In all the discussions we had since morning, it just seems that we are shackling each other up so much that the only people who can probably innovate without getting sued is the large companies. And which brings me to the not so good analogy of the wells that we had, which is the commons that India had, the wells, and that's taking the Indian example for you. So what kind of wells did we have? The wells were casteist wells. People of only a certain caste and above could go ahead and drink water from that well. That's what's happening in the knowledge world. Only people who got enough patents are permissible to come and use existing patents. If I come in and say, well, I have this patent and I want to use it, well, I can't use it without using other people's patents. My technology can't stand on its own. And if I want to use other people's patents, I'll get sued left, right, and center, unless I submit my patent into the well. So you have to have certain size to be able to operate in that regime that we're walking into. So you must be having enough patents on your own so that the Samsungs and the Sonys and the IBMs and Microsofts can't sue you, and the other way around. You can't sue them because they've got enough patents. And so only these are the small club of boys who can, or girls or whoever can use those patents. So that's the caste well system that we seem to be creating. Also, what I feel it's important to have government funding for such kind of innovations that doesn't exist at all. Government providing the ecosystem. As I said, yes, you can come out with examples of how without any support innovation is coming out, but if ecosystems are provided, like OSDT as an excellent example, much more innovation will come out. And the whole culture of invent once and harvest forever should go out. One of the examples I keep taking is just because Edmund Hillary went up the hill, it doesn't give him the authority to set up a checkpost every 1 kilometer and say, I will now collect a tax, because I was the first one to go up the hill. That's what's happening in terms of technology. Somebody who's out there, who has got the advantage, who is a couple of years ahead of you in terms of technology, will always keep putting in these forward blocks. And therefore you can't move forward, because by the time you move forward, there's another block, there's another patent there, by the time the patent expires, another patent is put into place, the next version is put into place, the old version is put out of warranty, is end of life. So you have to adopt the next generation of technologies. And therefore you always are faced with this kind of a, if I can say, discrimination. And what is essentially happening is there's a culture of invent once and use it forever kind of a in coming out. And if we can continue to have public funded research kept in public domains to be easily shareable by everyone. There's a whole bunch of things I've put in, but I think I've run out of time. But essentially, we need to have new business models, new operational models, new financial models. Who is going to support a startup which says, I'm going to create an open source technology? Very few. Very few VCs will come and support that. We need to have new financial models to ensure that these kind of ventures succeed. And then there should be new technology models. I'm tempted to take examples, but I'm just figuring out that Prabhu is getting fidgety, so I'll leave that. I'll just jump to the last few points, which I think is quite important, is the government should provide collaborative frameworks which are needed to support such kind of innovations. Such collaborative frameworks should not exist for the industry. If somebody in Manipur wants to collaborate with somebody in Kerala, that's not possible. And the same thing should exist for the educational system. It just does not exist. If somebody in Nagaland wants to collaborate with somebody in Agra to come out with a project on seven wonders of the world, such a system does not exist in this world. And in this country, I don't think it exists anywhere else. But the point is, we call ourselves an IT superpower. We want to have an innovative technology, an innovative society. But we don't have any system built in. We have not taken any step besides the lip service that we're talking about. So it's extremely important to have that. In terms of education, I heard certain discussions on that education must support both proprietary and open source technologies, and both should be taught. The fact of the matter is, you cannot. Pedagogically, you cannot, because you cannot come out of the book saying, here is how you open a file in Microsoft, here is how you open a file in Linux, and in KDD it will be in a different way, in some other interface it will be a different way. You cannot have that. You must choose one. In fact, that's one of the discussions that Richard and I had with CBSE. Thankfully, and with a lot of help from Abhishek, who went around showing the difference between what .NET and Java and so on, convinced them that open source is almost as good. They were still not convinced that it's better off. And let me take just one small example and stop over here. Why did I say that open source is normally far better off? Is, again, I'll take the OSGD example. One of the things that Anshu forgot to mention is that when they formed the groups of trainers and the trainees, nobody knew who the trainer is, nobody knew who the trainee is, because it was happening on the net. Finally, when they met face to face, it turned out that the students were training the teachers. Because it's an absolutely meritocratic system that comes up. The manager does not decide who the sub-manager is and so on and so forth and who the team lead is. The community decides. It's an absolutely harsh, dog-eat-dog meritocratic world, and which is why you get better software and better products out of this kind of system.
I really hate to do this and say, Evan, you have 10 minutes, because I would like to, in fact, listen to much longer.
How many years less? My friend Prodyut is right. He needs to apologize for being a politician, and I need to apologize for being a foreigner. The thing is that from now on, Mishy will be sitting here, but Prodyut will still be a politician. So here's the thing. I do come every once in a while to Eternal India to gain ancient wisdom. Folks like me, and it's true. I get it when I come here. I think Prodyut's right that the question is how to make the conversation more broadly accessible. The funny thing is that from my point of view, he had a third of the people to whom we have to broaden this out, which is the great mass of people who don't think about these questions from day to day. Jagjit has another third, which is the small and medium-sized businesses who have to be convinced that they don't have a stake in the continuance of the system. And the third class are the people that I was speaking about a moment ago, the large industrialists who have a very complicated choice to make that will be faithful to the long-term strategy of their industries over the next 18, 20 months, whatever you think it is, that their time schedule is. And we need slightly different ways of broadening the conversation for all three classes of the people. I also thought that Prodyut was right, that the fundamental of the global patent system at the moment is that it's about power and sovereignty, and that nationalism is a deeply important part of whatever is the theme that reaches the broad mass of people. And the question is, what is the national interest? This is also, as it turns out, the question we are discussing with the industrialists, it seems to me. What